We also have two couples, one celebrating their 9th and one celebrating their 13th anniversaries as well in December. We don't want to forget them. They're not here. They weren't honored this morning in the announcements. I'm just kidding. Anyway, but 9 and 13 years and the way our society is today, that's pretty good stuff. Actually, the 9 is partially here, so that's good. Anyway, have you ever told a half-truth? Anyone have experience with that? You don't have to raise your hand. Just think about that, because we probably have. I've experienced it. I can tell you that is one surefire way of staying in trouble. It really is. I mean, in fact, there are times when I told a half-truth that I really probably would have been better off if I had straight up lied. You know, I mean, really, that's just then tell a half-truth. But really, in either situation, you can rest assured that you're going to get caught and you'll have to pay for not telling the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. What about in your experience as parents? Did your kids ever tell you a half-truth? Yeah, probably so. I mean, well, half-truth, half-lie. I mean, let's stop kidding ourselves, right? You know, if it's not the whole truth, then it's a lie. It's that simple. But anyway, what'd you do to them when you caught them? Probably some stuff that would have the Department of Human Services called on you if somebody saw you doing it, right? Yeah, right? Because it's not a fun thing. It's not a good thing. I'm sure all of us have had some experience with a half lie. And from that experience, I think we would probably all agree that it's not a very pleasant thing. And it's not a very smart thing to do either. Along those same lines, have you ever left a job half done? I mean, you planned to finish it. It was in your mind to finish it. But something came up and, well, you didn't finish it for whatever reason. When I was growing up, one of my chores was to mow the yard. Now, mowing the yard is not the most fun thing in the world, right? So I tried to make it fun. So on Saturdays, I would lollygag around until Saturday afternoon, and I would race darkness to see if I could get it done. And most of the time I could do it because I knew how long it would take, and I knew when the sun was going to go down and it'd be too dark and whatever. Occasionally, I didn't exactly finish all the way. And when that happened, well, there was a wonderful little solution that my dad came up with. You finish it on Sunday afternoon. But Dad, I want to go be with my friend's house. You finish mowing the yard. That's the way it works. So anyway, a couple of times, you know, I had to do that. But one time in particular, I was in my little racing mode, trying to get to yard mode. And I got about 3/4 of the way done. See, most of the time it was about halfway, and I would have the front mowed but not the back, and so it didn't. No one really knew that I hadn't mowed the back, except for my dad. He knew. But anyway, I got about 3/4 done. Half of the backyard was mowed, and I couldn't go back on Sunday and finish it because I had something that I couldn't get out of that Sunday afternoon. And Monday came and I couldn't do it. And it was the next Saturday before I could go back and finish. Which, of course, by the next Saturday, the rest of the grass had grown, so I had to mow it as well. And that part that I had mowed was about yay high. The part I hadn't mowed was about yay high. It looked kind of silly, really, in the backyard for that week. But anyway, it took me twice as long to mow because of that patch that I hadn't mowed the week before. But anyway, the point being that a half done job sometimes is worse than a job that's not done at all. It's just that's the way that I see it. And I believe that's the way that God sees it as well. In 1 Samuel 15, we read about how Saul only did a job halfway, and it ended up costing him his kingdom, officially, okay? We've read about how he's fallen and all that other stuff, and all. This is the official point of no return, we might say, for Saul and his kingdom. Tonight, we're going to look at the story in 1 Samuel 15, and we'll do it in stages as we go through. In the first stage, it lets us know that the task was simple. Let's read verses 1 through 6 of 1 Samuel 15. And Samuel said to Saul, "The Lord sent me to anoint you king over his people Israel. Now therefore listen to the words of the Lord. Thus says the Lord of hosts, I have noted what Amalek did to Israel in opposing them on the way when they came up from out of Egypt. Now go and strike Amalek and devote to destruction all that they have. Do not spare them, but kill both man and woman, child and infant, ox and sheep, camel and donkey." So Saul summoned the people and numbered them in Telaim, 200,000 men on foot and 10,000 men of Judah. And Saul came to the city of Amalek and lay in wait in the valley. Then Saul said to the Kenites, "Go, depart. Go down from among the Amalekites, lest I destroy you with them, for you showed kindness to all the people of Israel when they came up out of Egypt." So the Kenites departed from among the Amalekites. Okay. The task was simple. Wipe out the Amalekites. The instructions were clearly delivered. Okay? God told Samuel to tell Saul to completely destroy the Amalekites. Okay? Now, I know a lot of times when somebody tells somebody else to tell a third person a message, sometimes the message gets a little bit crossed up and everything. That's not the case here, and we'll see why that is so. We know that it's so in just a couple of moments. But God told Samuel, and Samuel told Saul that God said, totally destroy the Amalekites. And again, Saul understood, and we'll see proof of that in just a couple of moments. The instructions were clearly delivered, but when you think about it, I mean, completely annihilating an entire people, that seems a bit extreme. I mean, why would God feel that way about the Amalekites? Well, the motives were clearly justified. Justified based on the Amalekites' treatment of the Israelites in the past. They had attacked Israel as they exited Egypt. In Exodus chapter 17, verses 8 through 16, you may remember the story. The Amalekites attacked the Israelites. The Israelites haven't even had a chance to train an army. But as long as Moses held his hands up, the Israelites won. But when he put his arms down, the Amalekites won. So, of course, Aaron and Hur held Moses' arms up, and Israel was victorious, even though they hadn't even trained an army, mainly because they weren't the ones fighting. God was the one that was fighting for them. But also, you can look at Deuteronomy 25, 17 through 19. It says, "Remember what Amalek did to you on the way as you came out of Egypt, how he attacked you on the way when you were faint and weary and cut off your tail, those who were lagging behind you, and he did not fear God. Therefore, when the Lord your God has given you rest from all your enemies around you, in the land of the Lord your God is giving you for an inheritance to possess, you shall blot out the memory of Amalek from under heaven. You shall not forget." Okay, this was Deuteronomy 25. Moses is still alive and writing Deuteronomy and all, and they haven't taken the promised land yet. But even then, God tells Moses, who writes it down in Deuteronomy, there's going to come a time when it's going to be time to pay the piper. You know, there's going to come a day of reckoning for the Amalekites. And on this occasion, 1 Samuel chapter 15, God says, it is time for the Amalekites to pay. It is time for the Israelites and God to get his revenge, we might say. Now, I told you earlier, God told Samuel, Samuel told Saul, and Saul got the message. How do we know that? Well, because the outsiders were clearly warned. Saul tells the Kenites, in so many words, you best be getting out of here. You need to leave because I don't want to destroy you when I destroy the Amalekites. The Kenites had helped the Israelites before, and so now Saul returns the favor. You know, Saul, for all of his faults, he knew his history. And so the Kenites had helped Israel, so now Saul tells the Kenites they need to leave so that they don't get destroyed with the Amalekites. And again, this is proof that Saul understood his instructions. He knew what he was supposed to do. He knew why he was supposed to do it. His task was simple. Wipe the Amalekites off the face of the earth. That's all he had to do. The task was simple, but the execution was sorry. Let's pick up in verse 7. And Saul defeated the Amalekites from Havilah as far as Shur, which is east of Egypt. And he took Agag, the king of the Amalekites, alive and devoted to destruction all the people with the edge of the sword. But Saul and the people spared Agag and the best of the sheep and of the oxen and of the fattened calves and the lambs and all that was good and would not utterly destroy them. All that was despised and worthless, they devoted to destruction. He attacks all the Amalekites. From Havilah to Shur to east of Egypt, the entire nation. It's not just a part of the nation. He doesn't just go after the capital city. He attacks all of the Amalekites, okay? So far, so good for Saul, okay? So he's attacked all of them. However, they let the best live. The best of the sheep and the cattle. He takes King Agag prisoner, verse 9 tells us. So here's the thing, the way the Israelites figured. If it was weak or despised, no problem destroying it. Yeah, it needs to be destroyed. It's worthless. But if it had any value, certainly God would understand. I mean, you know, you don't just destroy everything arbitrarily without looking at it and seeing if it has any value. And if it has value, you can't really, it's not really right to inherently destroy something of great value. I mean, why would God want them to destroy something of value? I mean, there's any number of quote unquote better uses for it, right? Well, you know, God would understand. This was holy war, or jihad as we've come to know it. This was a jihad. That means that everything was to be totally destroyed. And by total destruction, they would be giving it to God. Now, good example, well, not so good example of this is in the Battle of Jericho. Do you remember everything went great in the Battle of Jericho, didn't it? I mean, the walls fell down and the Israelites walked in and basically they won without much of a fight. All they had to do was destroy everything in the city because it was the first city in the promised land, and that's what they did. Except for Achan. You remember the guy named Achan? He took some of the devoted things and he hid them in his tent. And what happened the next time the Israelites went out to war? A couple thousand Israelites lost their lives because Achan took some of the things that were supposed to be totally destroyed and given to God in that way. Saul had a clear, simple instruction given to him. The execution just wasn't there. Back when I was in high school, as a senior, I played soccer. Well, I say I played soccer at practice, and then I sat on the bench during the games. This is the way it worked. But I was a goalie. And my senior year, I was the backup varsity goalie to a junior. Okay, now that didn't sit real well with me, okay? But, I'm not going to whine about it or whatever. I got that little letter jacket thing going on and, everything. Well, we had a bunch of injuries that year. And the junior that was playing goalie ahead of me went out and started playing in the field. And so I thought, this is great. I'm going to get to actually play my senior year. I'm going to get to play. Except the coach brought the starting JV goalie up, and he was a sophomore. And then the coach called me into his office. That's never a good thing, okay? And he says, now, Carl, I'm going to call Jose up. He's going to play goalie for us. I need you to help him learn how to play. What? And he said, no. He said, your brain knows what you're supposed to do, but your body can't do it. And I was like, well, he put it a little bit more bluntly than that. But anyway, the point being, that I had the heart, but not the tools. Well, Saul's problem was that he had the tools, but not the heart. He was going to do what he wanted to do the way he wanted to do it instead of what God told him to do. So the instructions were simple. The execution was sorry, and the punishment was severe. 1 Samuel 15, verses 10 through 35. We won't take the time to read all of that. But God was grieved that he had made Saul king. It says that not once, but twice in those 26 verses. Twice in verse 11 and in verse 35. Why was God grieved that he had made Saul king? Because Saul did not obey God anymore. Remember, at his coronation, he was humble. He was hiding in the luggage. And now, he's simply just doing whatever he wants to do. What about you? Do you ever think that maybe God might be grieved that he put you where he did? Just think about that for a moment. Saul started out humble, but the longer that he was king, the larger his ego grew. And maybe that's a trait of humans, of humanity. That, we start to get comfortable and we start to believe that, well, we deserve such and such or so forth. And when we start to do that, when our ego starts to grow, oftentimes, that's when God sort of gets shoved out of our lives. Saul had a problem. He didn't have time for God. He had time for what he wanted and his way of looking at things. And then he was the same old politician. He really was. He was the same old politician that he always had been. Check out verse 13 of chapter 15. Verse 13 says, and Samuel came to Saul, and Saul said to him, blessed be you to the Lord. I have performed the commandment of the Lord. Saul had technically probably done about 3/4 or so of the job that God had told him to do. But he tries to take credit for doing the whole job. And so he says, hey, the Lord be with you. I've done what God told me to do. And Samuel says, oh, really? Which part of the Lord's instructions did you carry out? Because I don't think you did. And Saul's brilliant answer, oh, the sheep and stuff. We saved it to offer in sacrifice to your God. Huh? Besides, it wasn't my fault. It was a soldier's fault. Okay, they didn't want to destroy the animals and so forth, and they thought they needed some payment or whatever. And so, you know, boys will be boys, you know, just, you know. Here's the king saying that he didn't have control of his army. And once Saul comes back with that, Samuel says it was so simple. All you had to do is to be God's tool in the destruction of the Amalekites. Why didn't you obey? Why didn't you just do what God told you to do? If you had, perhaps all this other stuff you'd done in the past, that could have been forgiven and forgotten. But because you didn't, well, you didn't obey God. And the kingdom's going to be taken from you. And we'll talk about that in a moment. But even after Samuel says this, Saul replies, "But I did obey. I totally destroyed the Amalekites, and I brought back their king. The soldiers are the one to lecture about concerning the sheep and cattle. But did you catch what he said there? I totally wiped out the Amalekites, and here's their king to prove it, alive and well, but my prisoner." He's convicted by his own words. His own words condemn him. He had not totally destroyed the Amalekites, as Agag's presence proved. And as a result of that, again, Saul's kingdom was lost. You see, the dearest thing to Saul was his kingdom. That was the most important thing to Saul, was his kingdom. And so his kingdom was lost. It's lost. It was lost. He would do anything to save it. For example, chapter 13, he tries offering sacrifices. He's not a Levite, he's not a priest, he's not supposed to be offering sacrifices, but his kingdom was threatened, and so he offers the sacrifices to rally the troops, or attempting to rally the troops. See, the bottom line is that good intentions are no match for obedience. Look at verse 22. "And Samuel said, 'Has the Lord as great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as in obeying the voice of the Lord?' Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to listen than the fat of rams." You know, we say, I had every intention of telling that person about the gospel, telling him about Christ, but there wasn't ever a really good opportune time, and I just never got around to it. And we think that God's going to buy that. But you see, God didn't tell us to plan to spread the gospel. God said, do it. God didn't say, form a committee and talk about it. Do a survey to gather information about people's strengths and weaknesses, and formulate a proposal that you can then take to the elders to see if we should be involved in evangelism, you know, and then if they say, no, we need to rework this, and you go back and redo it. And so he didn't say, think about it. He didn't say, plan to do it. He didn't say, hope to do it. He said, do it. Make disciples. But you know, there were some other aspects of the punishment to Saul. I mean, not only was God displeased, Samuel was displeased as well. In fact, Saul literally has to beg Samuel to come back with him. Now, if Saul had been truly sorry for not doing what he was supposed to do, then it'd be okay. But verse 30 tells us, then he said, "I have sinned.
Yet honor me now before the elders of my people and before Israel, and return with me that I may bow before the Lord your God.
Saul wasn't necessarily sorry that he had done what he did. He was sorry he got caught. And now he wants to try to save face. He wants to look good to the people. So Samuel, can't you come back with me so that I look good to the people in the kingdom?
Well, Samuel is a nice guy, I guess. And says, okay, but we got to finish the job first. So they call in Agag, who thinks that he's, you know, going to be okay. He's surely, you know, that you know, if Saul was going to kill me, he would have done it already. So he thinks everything's going to be fine and everything. Samuel takes care of him, though, does what God had told Saul to do, and runs him through with a sword.
There's a whole lot of people today who say belief is all it takes to get to heaven. Never mind countless passages in the Bible that reference baptism as part of the salvation process. They say, no, it sounds better for people just to believe, and that's all they have to do. The instructions are so simple. Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit, Acts 2, verse 38. Like the instructions to Saul, what could be simpler? Yet some people are unwilling to do even this simple act. There are other religious bodies that claim that once a person is saved, they can never be lost again. They emphasize the importance of baptism, but say once you're baptized, you can't be lost. If that's the case, why are there so many passages that warn against falling away? You know, that just doesn't make a whole lot of sense if it's impossible to fall away, for there to be warnings about it if you can't fall away. This is one of those half-lies, we might say. After baptism, you must continue to be a faithful Christian, faithful in attendance, in attitude, and in actions. For example, sharing your faith. Again, not planning to share it, but actually doing it. Now, both of these ideas may look good, like good ideas to us, but to God, they just don't hold water. Now, I'm sure that keeping the king and the best of the animals sounded like a good idea to Saul. I mean, especially the animals. I mean, they're animals. They didn't have anything to do with what the Amalekites did earlier. For that matter, neither did the people, that generation of people, because the ones that had done it were long gone. Saul may have even thought that he deserved it. He deserved to be rewarded. You know, payment for services rendered unto God, we might say. But it wasn't what God had said to do. So when Saul did it, he was punished. And he was punished by his most prized possession being taken from him, his kingdom. And oddly enough, Samuel tells him that God is going to find a man after his own heart to take his place. Does that describe you? Are you a man after God's own heart? Or are you someone who just wants what's best for you? Well, here's the thing. What's best for you is to follow the will of God for your life. May not feel like it at the time, may not seem like it at the time, but that's what's best for you. This evening, if you're not doing what's best for you, if you're not following the will of God, if you've been guilty of that half-hearted service like Saul was, repent. Maybe that means you need to privately repent. Maybe it means you need to publicly repent. Whatever that repentance is, please don't leave here with things not right between you and God. If we can help you through a public response, to do this, why don't you come to the front now as we stand and sing together?